You know, Monday I left Lewisburg, had to make a quick trip to Colorado. Ended up being at Colby on Monday night. So Tuesday morning I needed to come back through western Kansas. And I got up and left pretty early, before the sunrise. And typically I don't get outside the house at before sunrise. So, you know, it was confirmed. And two things this morning, I wasn't going to say anything. And then I'm the video this morning, and then what Kathy just said, being of this world. We are not of this world. We are in this world. And one of the things I got convicted of was when I saw the sunrise. And in western Kansas, when you're out there, I mean, there's a reason that not a lot of people live in western Kansas. I was born out there, and thank God we're not there anymore. But, you know, when you get out there, there's just really nothing out there. And all I could see was darkness. And then all of a sudden the sun starts coming up. And then there's the light. And that convicted me. Because I've been too much in the world, not of the world. A lot of us are that way. And in one particular thing, I've been kind of, and there's a lot of people that are really, really caught up in this election stuff. You know what? I think on the day after the election, the Lord's not going to say, "Wow, I didn't see that coming." You know what? Whatever happens, you know, and that's what, it convicted me of whatever happens, he's got control of this. Day to day, whatever happens, he's got control of this. We're too much in the world. We're just too much in the world. We're not in the world. We should be of the world. You know, at the end of our days, whenever that comes, we aren't going to be here anymore. And whatever happens, happens. You know, who's got tomorrow? I know who holds tomorrow. I know who holds my hand. You know, that's an old hymn that we've sang for years and years. The Lord has control of everything. He's not going to be surprised by this election. He's not going to be surprised by anything that happens. We should not be so concerned about the things in the world as we are things of the world. And that's just, that was impressed on me that, man, I was falling way, way short on that. I was getting too much involved in the worldly things and not enough in spiritual things. So this morning, sing like we're singing to the Lord. I mean, you know, we want to praise the Lord. No matter what happens, he's got this. He's not going to be shocked by anything that happens ever. He's got a plan. You know, I think one of the things that I find myself doing is I depend upon myself way too much. You know what? I'm going to solve this. There are some things I just can't solve. And I just have to say, you know what, Lord? Hey, this is yours. Take it. Figure it out, and I'll be good with whatever happens. That's the hard part, being good with whatever happens. The other part is whenever it happens. The society we live in today, you know what? If we wait 10 seconds in a microwave, and if it's not going, it's like we're all mad about it. Come on, man. Let's be real. The Lord's got his own timing on things, and we need to just accept that, realize that, and go forward. Let's sing. We stand and lift up our hands, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship him now. How great, how awesome is he, and together we sing, everyone sing. Holy is the Lord God Almighty, the earth is filled with his glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty, lift up our hands, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship him now. How great, how awesome is he,
rising up all around. It's the anthem of the Lord's renown. It's rising up all around. It's the anthem of the Lord's renown. And together we sing, everyone sings, holy is the Lord.
My story.
perfect delight. Visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending ring from above. Echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I and my Savior am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above. Filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior.
Holy, holy, holy.
shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, 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 holy. I want to see you
one more time.
do, I honor you.
Lord, we praise you today. We thank you, God, for your forgiveness. We thank you for your amazing love. God, I do pray, God, for myself today, God, that you would open the eyes of my heart. God, that I would not walk by sight, but I would walk by faith. God, that I would stand confident in what your word has already declared and the promises, Lord God, that your word says are yea and amen to those who believe. Father, I pray, God, that we would be confident, Lord God, in what your word declares over our own lives. And God, that we would stand in faith today, God, believing, Lord, that you're able to do exceedingly abundantly above everything we ask or think. Lord, you are far too great, Lord God. Far too great for us to make you weak in our own eyes. So, Father, I pray right now, God, that you would open the eyes of our heart, Lord. Help us to see you for who you truly are. A great and almighty, powerful, wonderful, miracle-working God, in whom nothing shall be impossible. Lord, we're here today, God, and Lord, some of us are up against some hard things. Some of us, Lord, have mountains standing in front of us. And Lord, we become weary, we become tired. The struggle, God, is truly great. But Lord, then we recognize, God, what your word declares over our lives, that you will never leave us and you will never forsake us. And God, if we will have faith the size of a mustard seed, that we will be able to speak unto this mountain. And this mountain will be cast into the sea. God, we stand in confident hope and trust today that what your word declares is true. And God, we are not going to accept anything else. We're not going to accept the lies of the enemy. We're not going to accept the lies of our own feelings that tell us there is no hope, or it feels like there is no hope. Lord, we know there's hope because Jesus Christ is alive today and he's seated at the right hand of the Father making intercession for us. So Lord, right now, God, as we make this house a house of prayer, God, we're believing that the miracle-working God that we serve, that we love, that we worship, we are believing that he is here. And that he is going to work in our hearts and work in our lives as we surrender to you, Lord. God, we surrender. You are our King, Lord. Help us, Lord God, not to hold on to the junk, but help us to let it go. Help us, Lord, to trust you with our lives. God, help us to rejoice in you, God, when your blessings are upon us and your favor has shown up in our lives. Oh, Jesus, you are far too good. Far too good, Lord God, for us to walk around depressed and hopeless. So, Jesus, right now, we turn our attention to you in prayer. We say, God, have your way in this church. Have your way in these people. Change our hearts, oh God. Cause us, Lord God, to trust you again. Because, Lord, you are worthy. We praise you and we thank you for it. If you need prayer today, we want to pray with you. Maybe you're that person where you've lost hope. There's still hope, church. I know your eyes may see something else. But don't pay attention to what your eyes see. Pay attention to what the faith says. Your faith in Jesus Christ says. want to pray with you. If you want to come and just find a place at the altar, that's fine too. But look, can we make this house a house of prayer? Can we just truly surrender to Jesus today and say, Lord, forgive me for doubting. Forgive me for looking in other places. Lord, I trust you today. Let's pray.
This is my desire to honor you, Lord, with all my heart, I worship you. All I have within me, I give.
Lord, have your way in me.
Praise you today that you are Jehovah Jireh. Lord, you're our provider. Your word declares, Lord God, that my God shall supply all my needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. God, I praise you, God, for the promises, Lord, that you give to us as we trust you, Lord. And God, I thank you, God, that part of trusting you, Lord, is giving. Sowing a seed, even when it seems like we don't have seed to sow. God, I pray, Lord God, we would sow our seed. I pray, God, that people will not eat their seed. But God, they will choose to sow their seed, God, and trust you in giving, Father. So, Lord, right now, God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we just pray your blessing over this offering, Father. We pray, Lord, that you would cause it to stretch and go further than we could ever imagine, to reach the least and the lost, the heartbroken and the downtrodden, Father. Help us, Lord, to reach this world for Jesus. We give you praise for it now. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God. I want to reiterate what Arlen said this morning. You don't have to be a recording artist to join the choir because I signed my name up, and y'all know I'm not a recording artist, so I'm sure y'all can hear me singing on Sunday mornings. I can't help it. I try to have volume control, but there's too much passion to worship to quiet myself down. So I apologize for if you don't like the sound, but hey, the Bible says make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Whether or not that's joyful or not, you know, that's to be determined. But, you know, praise God. For the last several weeks, we've been talking about reasons why our prayers may be going unanswered, right? And I just want to kind of go over the things that we talked about this far. The first week we talked about wrong motives, right? Wrong motives. Sometimes we pray and we ask so we can consume it upon our own lust, and God's not into that. God's not into us just our happiness, you know? It's just not about us being happy all the time, right? And then the next week we talked about having sin in our lives and how that can cause our sin, our prayers to go unanswered. And then the following week we talked about divided loyalty and how if we're double-minded, we shouldn't expect to receive anything from the Lord, is what the Bible tells us. And then last week we talked about how we need to respect husbands, we need to respect our wives, and how if we're not respecting them, we're not showing them honor, then that can hinder our prayers. I hope you've been getting something out of this. I hope God has been speaking to you and it's given you some clarification. Maybe you're one of those people where you're just sitting there like, man, I don't remember the last time my prayer got answered. I don't remember the last time my prayers got answered. And so maybe you're thinking that right now. And maybe God's trying to speak to you and say, hey, I'm telling you why your prayers aren't being answered. Are you listening? Are you listening to what I'm trying to tell you? Because this is straight from His Word. I'm not making this stuff up. It's already written, right? I just get to tell you all what He's already said, and it's good. Amen? And knowing this Word is very, very important, right? Because if we don't know the Word, then how in the world is the Holy Spirit going to bring it to our remembrance? Which reminds me about our Scripture exchange. If you didn't get to be a part of that last week, we're on Matthew chapter 2 now. You can still be a part of it. There's no, oh, well, you didn't do Matthew chapter 1, so you can't do it. But make sure you do that. It's awesome. I'm telling you. I sat down, I got out Matthew chapter 1, I typed up my notes, and man, it was good. It was good. Sometimes you read Matthew chapter 1, you look at the genealogy, and you're like, what in the world could I possibly get out of this? But I'm telling you, there's a lot you can get out of that. There's a whole lot you can get out of that. So I encourage you to get a piece of paper, sit down with Matthew chapter 2, and see what the Lord wants to say to you and see what He wants to reveal to you through His Word. All right, James chapter 5, verse 16 is where we're going to start at. That's our verse of this unanswered prayer. It says, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The earnest prayer of a righteous person has great power and produces wonderful results. Again, we all want wonderful results. That's something we all desire when we pray. We just want to see God shower us down with the answers and just give us those results. But the one thing I want to focus on this morning is as we confess our sins to one another, we then pray for spiritual healing in each other's lives, right? We don't look at each other and say, man, I can't believe you did that, you loser. How could you do that, right? Man, I can't believe you. Are you serious? You really did that? Okay, that person's never going to talk to you again about anything they've ever done wrong. But we should have compassion because we all know that we have fallen. We've fallen short of the glory of God, right? And if we look at other people and we say, man, I cannot believe you. I can't believe you did that. I can't believe you said that. Then we have just become the judge rather than the person of mercy, right? And we're not the judge, are we? Jesus gets the privilege of doing that and being that, and I'm okay with that. But sadly, many times we confess our sins to one another, and we are looked down upon or shunned for them. You ever seen people shunned for their sin? Yeah, it happens. Even happens in the church, unfortunately. But we don't ever want it to happen in this church. I hope everybody feels comfortable where they can go to somebody here and they can say, you know what, I've fallen short. I've done the wrong thing here. And I hope the people are just putting their arm around and saying, hey, we can get through this together. Right? Because as Jesus said, he was without sin, cast the first stone. So just as God is forgiven, we must forgive and show mercy rather than judgment. It was a cold night in February 2007 when the car holding Chris Williams and his family was hit by a 17-year-old drunk driver. Immediately, Chris checked on his children in the back seat and quickly realized his 11-year-old son and 9-year-old daughter had died. Then as he watched, his pregnant wife sitting next to him exhaled for the last time. Meanwhile, Williams was in so much pain he could barely move. His arm to turn off his car's engine. However, before he had even been rescued from his car, think about this. This man's sitting here in his car, this wreckage just happened. He's got two deceased children in the back seat. A pregnant wife that just breathed her last, and now the baby's dying as well. And this is what he did. Said, however, before he had even been rescued from his car, Williams told the Deseret News, he had this thought: whoever has done this to us, I forgive them. Wow. I don't care what the circumstances were, I forgive them. He proved as good at his word, going on to publicly forgive his family's killer and developing a relationship with him and his family. Today, Williams is a motivational speaker, sharing his incredible story of healing and forgiveness and inspiring others to extend mercy and forgiveness as well. Wow, right? Yeah, I think we're all like, wow. I don't know how anybody could do that. I think about my children, I think about my wife, and I think about, wow, if something happened like that to them, what would I do? How would I respond to that? How would I be able to live with that? And I hope that I would respond like this man did. As difficult as it would be, I hope that I would respond like this man did. I choose to forgive. Maybe he had been a 17-year-old drunk driver that never hit someone. Right? You know, it's easy to start becoming judgmental and start saying, well, I can't believe you did that, but I did it and didn't get caught. I didn't hit a car. It's easy to become that way, easy to start thinking that way, but many of us have done the same thing, but we just didn't face the consequences. Nothing serious happened, but it could have been us. That could have been me, right? And as difficult as it would be, I can honestly say that kid, that 17-year-old kid driving drunk, that could have been me. I was 17 years old once, and yes, I did drive under the influence of alcohol. So that could have been me. Praise God it wasn't. But I would have needed forgiveness if it was. What do you think it did for that kid? I could imagine, just think about it, this kid being having charges brought against him, knowing that he killed 4 family members. What would that make you want to do to yourself? Probably tie something around your neck and just jump off a cliff, right? But man, I don't know the rest of the story. There is a movie coming out about this that would be probably pretty powerful to watch, to see what forgiveness looks like and how it's lived out. But can I just say this? There's a lot more petty things than this that we are refusing to forgive, isn't there? A lot more petty, a lot smaller things that we refuse to forgive people for. So today, that's what we're going to be talking about. Did you know that unforgiveness will hinder your prayers? If you choose to harbor unforgiveness towards someone in your life, your prayers will be hindered. Jesus tells us in Mark chapter 11. Mark chapter 11, if you have your Bibles with you, you can turn there. But Jesus tells us in Mark chapter 11, he says, I tell you, you can pray for anything, and if you believe that you've received it, it will be yours. But when you are praying, First, forgive anyone you are holding a grudge against, so that your Father in heaven will forgive your sins too. Did you hear that? When was the last time any of us got in our prayer closet and we began to pray and we're like, oh, I've got to leave. I got to go talk to somebody and I got to go forgive them. Anybody? When was the last? No, we just get in there and we just take for granted. Oh, it doesn't matter what kind of feelings I have towards anybody. I can live my life however I want. I can be unforgiving. I can be bitter. I can have this bitterness in my heart. And you know what? It doesn't matter. I can still just come into my prayer closet and expect God to move in my life. I know. I've done it. I've done it too. But this isn't what God wants us to do. He's saying, you know what? If you're going to come into your prayer closet, stop it. If you have something against something, leave. Leave your prayer closet and go to that person and work it out. You see, the reason why unforgiveness is necessary and it will hinder our prayers, because if we don't forgive, then we can't be forgiven. And if we're not forgiven, that means we have sin in our hearts. And what hinders our prayers? Sin hinders our prayers. It says, when you stand praying, forgive. What is causing you not to forgive today? What's causing you not to forgive? What is it in your life? What is it that happened to you? What is it did somebody do to you that was so horribly bad that you're like, there's no way I can forgive. There's just no way. I can't do it. And can I just tell you this? I've said this before, but I feel like I need to say it right now, is forgiveness is not a feeling. You're not going to be like, man, I just feel like forgiving them now. Pastor, thank you for pointing it out to me. I just feel so forgiving now. Right? No, forgiveness is a choice. You're going to have to say, you know what? Pastor just preached the Word of God today, and I'm convicted. I'm going to choose to respond to that conviction, and I am going to forgive the people that have hurt me. Right? But it's a choice. I told you before, you're not going to wake up tomorrow morning and be like, man, I just feel like I'm in a forgiving mood today. I'm going to forgive everybody that's ever done me wrong. It's going to be a great day, right? It's not going to happen. We have to choose to forgive. Jesus says again in Matthew chapter 5 and verse 23, so if you are presenting a sacrifice at the altar in the temple, and you suddenly remember that someone has something against you, basically it's saying, hey, if you're coming to church and you remember that someone has something against you, listen to what he says. It says, leave your sacrifice there at the altar. Go and be reconciled to that person. Then come and offer your sacrifice to God. Did you hear that? Now it's not just about you having something against someone else. It's about, does someone have something against you? Have you offended somebody? Do you need to seek reconciliation? Have you upset someone? Now, I know, here's our attitude in today's world. Well, if they're upset, they can go fly a kite. Right? That's not my problem. If they're upset, they need to choose to get over it. Right? But there's times where we have to apologize even when it's not us that should be apologizing. As hard as that is sometimes, we have to go to them and say, hey, I offended you, and I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Two of the hardest words to say in the human vocabulary, right? You guys remember Fonzie from Happy Days? You ever remember watching Happy Days? Every time he did something wrong, which was very, very, not very often, right? According to him. But when he did, right, he would have to say those two words. But this is how it would go. It'd be, he just couldn't get it out, right? Because it's like, no, I'm, you know, for me to be sorry, that means that I did something wrong. And he never wanted to admit that. But you see, sometimes it's that hard for us, isn't it? Sometimes it's that hard for us just to go and just say those two simple words, I'm sorry. And what difference can it make? Man, I just did that. And I'm telling you, whether or not you realize or not, when you're willing to do that, it does lift something off your shoulders. And you're like, man, so glad I did that. Now I can go back into my prayer closet. And, you know, I can sit before the Lord without guilt, right? I can sit before Him and I can offer this sacrifice to Him. And He's going to accept it because I know my heart is right with Him. Because I've forgiven. But how many of us like confrontation? Anybody? Confrontation is not an easy thing, is it? See, I think we look at it as a lot of times we confront, but I think we do it wrong a lot of times. Why? We confront with the attitude that we're right and they're wrong. Okay, and when we confront with that type of attitude, you know what happens? It doesn't go well. Right? They get defensive because you're walking up here like, hey, I got to talk to you about something. You remember the other day? Yeah. Well, I didn't think that was right. But I'm sorry. Yeah, it doesn't really work, right? Okay, God, that's not the attitude we need to have. And you know, but here's the thing, we have to be willing to confront things. We have to be willing to confront people. We have to be willing to let our guard down at times and say, hey, I love you and our relationship is way more important to me than being right. Okay, I know that's difficult. I know that's hard. But you know what? It's worth it. If you care at all about your relationships. And some of us, you know, it's like, well, yeah, I'm married to that person. Of course I'm forgive them. Of course we can work through this. But what about the people that you're not married to? That maybe you're just going to see every once in a while. It's like, ah, oh, it's not a big deal. I just see them every once in a while. I don't need to forgive them. Yeah, you do. You need to confront that. But here's the problem is we live in such a passive-aggressive world today. Right? Passive-aggressive to where we, instead of confrontation, we just make snide remarks in a joking way. Okay? Just to kind of point out that they're wrong. Amen? Or, we talked about this in a small group a couple weeks ago, or we post it on Facebook and hope they get on Facebook that day so they can see how wrong they are by our post. Even though we're not going to direct it towards them or even tag them in it, we want them to know that I'm posting this on Facebook for them and hopefully they'll read it and they'll have a change of heart. Has that ever worked for anybody? I haven't ever seen it work for anybody, but I'm telling you, that's how we deal with stuff anymore. That's how the world deals with things is they start throwing stuff all over Facebook and they think that that's going to solve conflict. Wow. That's sad, isn't it? That's immaturity at its finest. But yet we still do it. You see, conflict avoidance is an unhealthy model for relationships. Avoiding conflict never makes it go away, right? Avoiding conflict is never going to make forgiveness in your heart towards someone. But there's times where we just have to bite the bullet, so to speak, and say, okay, I'm here. I want to resolve this. Now, can I tell you this? All we can do is what we can do. Okay, if you go to someone and you got a humble attitude and you go before them and you say, you know what, I'm sorry. Please forgive me. I don't want to have this unresolved conflict with you any longer. And they say, whatever, talk to the hand. Okay, that used to be popular. It's not anymore, but you know, talk to the hand. If they say that, then you're off the hook. Okay, you've done your part, right? And you can go before God now with a guilt-free conscience and say, God, I've done my part. I have forgiven. Lord, I no longer am holding a grudge towards them. And if they're still offended, God, I have sought forgiveness from them. So, confrontation is a way God wants us to deal with relationships. What if you did have a problem in your marriage relationship and you chose just to ignore it? You think that's going to make things better for your marriage? No. You're going to deal with it eventually. And it's probably going to be this one big old blown up thing. It's like, how in the world did we get from you forgot to put the dishes in the cabinet, right, to this? Why? Because it wasn't about the dishes. Amen? It was never about the dishes. What happened is you had unresolved conflict that you avoided. And now the dishes has escalated into something huge when it didn't need to. Isn't that amazing how that works? So it's up to us if we want to confront the situation and resolve it and be able to have healthy relationships, or if we just want to ignore it and hope that it goes away and our relationships remain healthy. But I'll tell you right now, it's not going to work. It hasn't worked for 6,000 years. It's not going to work now. Unforgiveness is a relationship killer. Did you hear that, church? Unforgiveness is a relationship killer. And many of you know you have relationships that are dead because of unforgiveness right now. Right? Jesus had a lot of stuff to say about this. So we're now in Matthew chapter 6, verse 14. It says, "If you forgive those who sin against you, your heavenly Father will forgive you. But if you refuse to forgive others, your Father will not forgive your sins." Now, it's no coincidence that Jesus said these words right after he got done telling the disciples how to pray. Right? Right after he said, okay, this is how you should pray. He then said, now, if you have unforgiveness, you're not forgiven. So, I want you to understand something. Praying's a wonderful thing. But if you have unforgiveness in your heart, don't expect any good results. Because it's not going to happen. Because our prayers become ineffective and powerless when unforgiveness is in our hearts. Have you ever thought about this? Man, if I don't forgive, then I'm not forgiven. When was the last time you went to God and said, God, forgive me for my sins? And now you're thinking, man, I don't know if he really did. Because I'm so mad at that person that I just want to spit, right? I just want to spit right here on the ground. I'm just so mad. And God's saying, you know what? I want to forgive you. I do. Can I just say this? God wanted to forgive you so much that he sent Jesus as a sacrifice for your sins. That's how badly he wanted to forgive you. Isn't that amazing? Okay, what if we wanted to forgive people as much as the Father wanted to forgive us? Wow. How would that change this world, right? How would that change your relationships if your desire for forgiveness was as much as the Father's desire for forgiveness was? Again, it's a choice, but the only person that we are hurting for not forgiving ourselves is me. And possibly the people we're praying for. Okay, because if we've got unforgiveness in our hearts and we're praying for other people, God's not hearing those prayers, and therefore God's not moving in their lives either from our prayers. So we forgive to be free. Everybody likes to be free, don't they? What if I went around and I put chains on everybody's arms today? And I said, you know what, why don't you just go through the day just like this? Would you guys be excited about that? No, it's okay. No, really, you're going to be in bondage the rest of the day. Is that all right with you? Nobody would want that. Nobody would desire that. Nobody would be like, no, Pat, I don't want chains on my arms. Don't put those on my arms. But see, what we're doing, though, that's exactly what we're doing. We're sitting here with chains on our arms if we are choosing not to forgive people. We're putting chains on our own prayer life when we're choosing not to forgive people. Colossians 3 and verse 13 says, "Make allowance for each other's faults and forgive anyone who offends you. Remember, The Lord forgave you, so you must forgive others. Ephesians 4:32, instead, be kind to each other, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, just as God, through Christ, has forgiven you. Both of these scriptures talk to us about forgiving. Why? Because Jesus has done it for us, right? The Father has done it for us. Okay, if any of us can sit here this morning and say, well, the Father's never forgiven me for anything, then hey, go ahead and keep on unforgiving. Okay, keep on in your unforgiveness. But if you truly believe, if you truly know that Jesus has forgiven you for everything in your life and you're still choosing not to forgive, then there's a problem. Right? But just about in everyone's mind here today, many of us are thinking, well, they did far worse than what I did to them. Pastor, if you knew the story, let me tell you the backstory of why I can't forgive. Okay? Go for it. You know, the results are still going to be the same at the end of the story. You have to choose to forgive. Right? Okay, we can tell the story. We can justify why we're not forgiving, why we can't do it. But God's demand for forgiveness is still going to be on our lives. But here's the thing, is everyone else's sin is always far worse than our own in our minds. Everybody, what somebody else has done is always worse than what I've done. Come on. Come on, I look around the world, it's like, man, there's so many sinners in the world. Look at all that they do all the time. But then God says, hey, look in the mirror. I'm like, oh, ouch, thanks God. He said, yeah, you need to stop pointing fingers and stop looking and seeing all these people that have done so much more wrong than you and realize that your sin is no better than theirs. Today we get to forgive. I want to share a story with you. There was once a very poor orphan who wanted nothing more in the world than to belong to a family. Finally, this opportunity came. He was 8 years old and a family wanted to adopt him. That's got to be an exciting time, right, for an orphan? Introductions were made, papers were signed, and just 6 days after his 8th birthday, he left for his new home. He took with him his hope and his possessions, the old worn and torn clothes he was wearing, and a single soft toy. His new parents were excited to have him with them and wanted him to feel like one of the family. A special celebration dinner was held. He was given his own room and he was introduced to the other kids in the street. His new parents took his old clothes, threw them away, and bought him beautiful new clothes. They bought him a bike and more toys, and pretty soon he began to feel just like all the other kids in the neighborhood. Loved and part of a family. One thing, however, was curious. The young boy's old shoes, the one with the big holes in them, weren't tossed out with the rest of his clothes. His new father placed them on the mantelpiece. It wasn't long before the newly adopted son would go to get these shoes and say, look, it wouldn't be long before the newly adopted son found out why that these shoes were up here. Every time the boy did something wrong, his father would go and get the shoes and say, look at what we've done for you. Unfortunately, he said, we took you in when you had nothing, but you look how you have misbehaved. Unfortunately, we do the same thing all too often in our relationships. We dredge up the past and throw it back in someone's face, never throwing out the shoes as well as the clothes, refusing to dredge up the past and make it a reason for action in the present. It's our choice, isn't it? How many of us have got those old shoes sitting there and we're thinking, yeah, hey, I, you know, that's great. You're doing great. But then when somebody messes up, when somebody does something to us, we are like, hey, you remember what you did back here? And we get upset all over again. You want to know you've forgiven someone? Is when you can think about it and it no longer makes you angry. I want to end this morning with these lyrics from this song. You guys have probably heard this song, but maybe you haven't ever paid that much attention to the lyrics. It goes like this. It's the hardest thing to give away. The last thing on your mind today. It always goes to those that don't deserve. It's the opposite of how you feel. When the pain they caused, it's just too real. It takes everything you have to just say the word, forgiveness. Forgiveness. It flies in the face of all your pride. It moves away the mad inside. It's always anger's own worst enemy. Even when the jury and the judge say you got a right to hold a grudge. It's the whisper in your ear saying, set it free. Forgiveness. Forgiveness. Show me how to love the unlovable. Show me how to reach the unreachable. Help me now to do the impossible. Forgiveness. Forgiveness. Help me now to do the impossible. It'll clear the bitterness away. It can even set a prisoner free. There is no end to what its power can do. So let it go and be amazed. By what you see through eyes of grace, the prisoner that it really frees is you. Forgiveness. Forgiveness. God, show me how to love the unlovable. Show me how to reach the unreachable. Help me now to do the impossible. Forgiveness. I want to finally set it free. So show me how to see what your mercy sees. Help me now to give what you gave me. Forgiveness. Forgiveness. If that's your heart today, if that's what you are thinking and that resonates in your heart and in your soul today, and you're saying, Pastor, I need to forgive. I've held on to it far too long. I want you to stand right where you're at. If you're saying, you know what, I need to get rid of some unforgiveness in my heart today. I need to release it. I need to release it because I want to be free. I want to be free. Come on, church. Come on, don't waste this opportunity. God wants to make you free today. God wants to make you free, and the only way you're going to get free is by saying, I forgive, and meaning it, making that choice, and not allowing the enemy to use that against you any longer. Praise God. Anyone else? Come on, we don't want to pass this opportunity up. If you have unforgiveness in your heart, today's the day to get free. The bitterness has to go. Jesus is here to set you free. Hallelujah. The ones that are standing, I want you to pray with me today. And then I want you to pray your own prayer. But right now, we're going to make the declaration, and I want you to mean this with your whole heart, because if you want to be free today, you have to mean this. You have to make this choice. Dear Heavenly Father, I choose today to forgive that person's name. Go ahead and say it. I choose to forgive them, Lord. I will not hold a grudge. But I release them, and I release myself from unforgiveness. Lord, I don't want to go through this life any longer with unforgiveness in my heart. So, Lord, if there is anybody else in my life that I need to forgive, bring it to my attention now so I can forgive, Lord. I want my prayers to be powerful. I want you to hear them. I want you to respond to them. In Jesus' name, amen. Father, we just want to say thank you today. We want to say thank you that you cared so much about forgiving us, that you sent Jesus, your only begotten Son, to die a painful death on the cross so that we could be forgiven. Lord, there is no greater gift that you have given to us than the gift of forgiveness. You wiped our slate clean, Lord. Thank you, God, for giving us the privilege and the blessing of extending that same forgiveness to those that have hurt us, to those that have sinned against us, to those that have offended us. We thank you right now, Jesus. We thank you for the healing, God, that's manifesting itself, God, in each heart that has been set free today. And God, we receive that healing. We receive your love. We receive your mercy. And we receive your grace to forgive in the future, to love the unlovable, and to show mercy to those we don't believe deserve mercy. Lord, thank you for loving us, and thank you for extending mercy when we didn't deserve it. We love you, we praise you, and we honor you. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, amen. Praise God. Yes, give God a hand clap today. Some prisoners got set free today. Hallelujah. Aren't you glad? Okay, keep choosing to forgive. If you still feel anger, just again pray, God, I choose to forgive. In Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you all. I love you. Have a great day.